dropped my phone just as I was starting. How's the sound? Can you hear me? Hello? Here comes some people. Hello. Hi, Cosmo. Hi, everyone. Can you tell me if you can hear me? How's the sound? Hi, it's been a while. We're going to do some cooking today with my friend Haneen. She just needs to join. Let me see if she's here. Thank you, Jose. Nope. All right. And can you hear the Feroz music in the background? And is it a good balance with my voice? All right, good. You can hear the Feroz. Excellent. Got a few of her albums now, and I found out that she's the mother of Zaid Rabani, who is fast becoming one of my favorite composers, period, and arrangers. His stuff is so funky and cool, and like this mix of traditional Arabic, Palestinian, or I guess Lebanese music, and like funk, soul, rare groove, jazz. It's unbelievable. Hi, Sheila. We're just waiting for Haneen. There she is. I'll show you the album later. There she is. Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm as best as I can be in this time.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, you told me that you got to speak to some people in Gaza today.
Yeah, I got to speak to some family members after quite a while of not being able to reach out and get to know how are they. So it's a relief to hear them, to hear their voice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for doing this. This was your idea, and I'm so excited to do it. We're going to be enjoying some Palestinian culture today and cooking.
Yes.
You can see my hat. It's backwards, but you can see it. Free Palestine.
You can see your hat, yes.
Yeah, someone sent it to me.
You can see it, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, right. What are we doing? Tell us what
I'm
we're
really
cooking.
I'm glad that you were up to the challenge of cooking and living. So,
well,
we're going to do it.
Yeah, not only that, but I'm brave enough to show everybody how messy my place is right now. Like, it's ridiculous. But this is, and I wish I could say this is not normal, but it actually is extremely normal. So, anyway. Yeah. Come as you are, right? So,
of course.
Yeah. So tell us what we're cooking while I start to, I'll just sort of show people the ingredients I have here. Again, the mess is ridiculous, but I got some bell peppers. This is the flour that I fried the fish in. I got some onions. That's tomatoes.
All right.
That's the oil. Mm-hmm. You can see a mess was made. Got
yep.
some rice here. And then over here, we got the fried fish. Does that look okay?
Yeah.
It fell apart, but I didn't quite know how to not make it. So this is going to be an amateur version. I already told Haneen, I forgot to buy the lemon, and I dipped the fish, half the fish, in the wrong spice. But it'll mm-hmm. still be a tasty spice.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm going to start doing is...
We're gonna try to make like cookies now.
Sorry, the sound is a little muffled. Can you see if you can fix that?
Because
we want to hear what you're saying.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, but it's a little unclear.
Now?
Much better.
Okay.
So today we're going to be, it's Sayadieh. It's called Sayadieh.
Jayadieh?
It's called Sayadieh.
I'm using my Palestinian olive oil.
Great. I'm using Portuguese olive oil.
Well, that's fine too.
Yes.
But you know, Haneen, it's a little more authentic, you know? What I'm using, it's a little more... I'm not saying you're not really Palestinian, but I mean, look, you know.
Yes, okay. Okay. Yeah. No. Okay.
All right, so I'm heating up the oil and I'm going to fry the onions first, I'm right?
I'm going to respond to the comment about the olive oil.
Yeah, please don't.
I'm not going to say anything to it because it's olive oil.
It's olive oil.
I can't
olives
say anything to it. Palestinian olive oil is the best. I cannot say anything to that Palestinian olive oil.
I got you on that. So first I'm going to saute, right. I'm going to fry the onions first, and like after a while, then the garlic and then the bell pepper. Is that right? Give me the order.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you
tell us about...
Start frying.
Okay.
And I want to tell about the recipe.
Yes, please tell us.
Because it's called Sayadieh. It is called Sayadieh, and this is a very well-known recipe in Palestine and also in the Middle East. And in different Arab countries, it has different names, actually. But in Palestine, we call it Sayadieh. And Sayadieh, it's made with fish. It's made with fish and vegetables, like tomato and bell pepper and onion and garlic and rice. And why is it very well known and famous? Because it's a recipe from the fishermen in Gaza.
Mm.
Because Gaza is on the Mediterranean Sea and there's a lot of fishing that happens on the sea or from the sea. And that's why there was so many different recipes in the Palestinian kitchen related to fish. And the fishermen, the story of the Sayadieh. Daniel, I'm sorry, can you just a little bit tone it down?
Feroz, we're trying to cook here, Feroz. Give us a minute. You're beautiful, but Haneen's talking. All right. Go ahead.
Thank you. I love Feroz, by the way. I sing her songs all the time.
Yeah, but music while streaming is tough.
Yeah, it's just a little distracting for me.
Yes.
So did you start the frying?
Yes, I'm frying the onions first, and when they get a little soft, then I'll add what, the garlic first or the peppers or the tomato?
You can add, like after you fry the onion, the garlic and the pepper together and fry everything, and then you add the tomato after they are fried.
Okay, and then the spices and then the water and the rice?
And then the spices and the water and the rice.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, it's better to fry the tomato.
Okay.
Yeah. And food is a big part of the culture, because it's not only about the food itself, it's about the process of making the food and how people make it together. And it's like a kind of an action that brings people and community more together and closer. So that's why it's a big part of the Palestinian culture.
And then I imagine serving it and eating it together as well, like the whole... How long does a Palestinian meal last? You know how Italian meals are like 4 hours long?
It's quite long because the cooking takes time and the eating period takes time and the after period, like drinking coffee, after food takes time and talking. And as I said, it's always the times that you have together, the gatherings that we have together, not like... next to the food as well, but the gathering. So more than 4 hours, actually. In my family gatherings, we would spend the whole day together.
Oh, amazing.
Especially for cooking Sayadieh. But
Unfortunately, the fishermen in Gaza have not been able to really fish since the blockade was imposed on Gaza City. They couldn't even enter more than 3 kilometers to be able to do the fishing.
Yeah.
And this is one of the things that has affected the lives of the people, and specifically the fishermen.
So, two things about, okay, can I ask a question?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
I have a question. I want to go back to something you said before. But first, I don't know if you saw, I did an episode of a podcast called Bad Hasbara, and we interviewed a guy named Noy Katzman, who's currently in Germany, but he's Israeli born. His brother, Chaim Katzman, was killed on October 7th at Kibbutz Holit. And he talked about how when he served in the Navy, and he's an anti-Zionist now, he's, you know, a peace activist and completely against the genocide and has been, you know, active in that. But when he was in the Navy, when he was a lot younger, before he knew better, they served in the Gaza waters, and they crashed into a fisherman's boat once, and it was like there was this tragedy, you know, it was an accident. But I said to him, it was an accident, but it's no accident that you guys were there, and you shouldn't have been there in the first place, you know, like you didn't. And he said, yeah, absolutely, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to ask you about the meals, family meals, spending all day together. To a lot of people in the West, and this says a lot about Western culture, that would sound like hell on earth to spend all day with your family. And obviously, I'm sure Palestinian families have their stuff, have their, I don't know, neuroses, if that's a thing, like stuff. But is there estrangement, and is there the kind of tension that would make people kind of really tense to be around the table together the way there so much is on this continent?
Yes, I think it's in every culture there's these kind of tense things that might have come on the table or during the day.
Yeah.
But it's normal. We have it also in the Palestinian culture. But it just does not stand in the way of bringing the family together or being together and eating together. Even if you're not speaking to a person, it doesn't mean that you can be in the same space together. Like you can interact with other family members. You can still be part of the family and the togetherness. And especially in the community in Gaza, like Friday, for example, is really like a holy day. It's not only about a prayer, but it's really about being with friends and family and spending. People really cherish this kind of being together, this kind of way of being together. So, yeah, I don't know if that answers your question.
Totally does. It sounds like a culture where you can have your individual stuff, but there's some container that's holding it that is sacred and that's honored.
See, which is also in that part, which is also having the elderly, the older people, when they are in the space, there's a certain, like there's a respect for them and for their presence.
Sorry, someone was requesting that the food prep be seen, but we can't do both.
Yeah.
This is not a professional cooking show.
Yeah.
Well, that's very interesting. Okay, so what else? What else about this dish or about Palestinian food? Let me ask you this. A lot of people make the mistake of thinking there's such a thing as Arab food, which would be as silly as thinking of that there's North American food or European food. Every culture is different. So what are some of the differences between Palestinian cuisine and, say, Syrian or Lebanese or Egyptian?
There is a difference. You cannot generalize. They each have their own way of doing the dish. Like, for example, hummus is in the Middle East. It's all Arab countries. Like Sayadieh, there's many Arab countries have it. But it's just the way the recipe, the way to do it, and the recipe you use, and that's the difference.
Mm.
You say Egyptian fool, even though in Palestine we have fool, and we say Palestinian fool.
So, those are fava beans, right?
Yeah, fava beans.
Yes, exactly.
So that's what we call
it. It's the recipe itself. It's about the recipe itself and the way each one does it.
And is there...
I know many people here generalize a lot. Like, I need that a lot also personally.
Yeah.
But there's different ways of doing to each one of us. It's different recipes.
And is there competitiveness? Like, are Palestinians sure that Lebanese food is okay, but we know the real cuisine?
Look, everyone thinks their food is the best food.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
So yeah, I think it's part of it. That's part of
Without
it.
Without putting anything. What are you doing?
I'm just confirming that Palestinians are like everybody else. They're chauvinists about their own food.
I mean,
that's what I would expect.
Proud of your food, and
of course
think
you
it's
are.
The best, and you love the recipe, but also I like the recipe of the way that my Lebanese friend does the hummus, for example.
Oh, we have an Algerian.
And I don't try to tell him, but this is how I do it. I appreciate his recipe, and I like it, and I eat it.
Yeah. We have an Algerian in the chat claiming that Algerian is the best. North Africa in the house.
Algerian food is great. I love Algerian food too.
Yeah, well, now you start to get into African tastes and things like that. All right, I've got all my ingredients in here. The tomato is frying. I'll give it another few minutes. And then can you tell me again what proportions of what spices? I've got nutmeg, I've got cumin, I've got turmeric, and ginger powder. Turmeric is curcuma.
Yeah, you can put, I mean, that's the trick here, because my grandmother and my mother would tell me, just put from these spices.
Right.
And I think I will do the same to you.
Okay.
I think I will do the same
that's
to
cool.
you,
I've,
Daniel. You
I've,
can just put.
I've cooked enough to know.
Great. Whatever you feel is right.
Yeah.
My mother never gave me a specific proportion of recipes. That's why.
And then I'll mix that in, and then I'll add the water and the rice, bring it to a boil, put a lid on, and turn it down.
Yes. Yes. And then we add the fish later. Thank you.
Correct.
Yeah.
And if I didn't have something on the stove, and if I didn't live alone, I would take you to the store and buy a lemon, but I forgot. I always forget one
Where's
thing.
Where's the stove?
The store is a block away, but I'm not going to leave my gas stove on while I go. I'm just not going to do that.
No, you cannot do that.
All right, there's the nutmeg. Here's the turmeric. I would not be
perfect.
I would not be a good cooking show host.
But you're doing great.
Thank you.
I think we're enjoying, and people are seem to be enjoying.
Yes.
It's doing good.
Yes.
I like Nizana, my grandma too. Okay, nice. Daniel, you need a cooking show. Why, you see, people are saying you need a cooking show.
I've got enough going on, folks. How long was your grandmother in your life, assuming she's not no longer alive?
She's no longer with us. She died in 2016. And she's a Nakba survivor. Mm-hmm. And I mean, she survived Nakba. She came to Gaza with my grandfather, and they lived in Gaza for all their lives until she died in 2016.
Wow.
And we are like four generations of living in Gaza.
So it really is home. And you lived there until very recently,
yes.
Right? A couple of years ago.
Yeah, I just left 5 years ago. It's not so far. And actually, like, what is really heartbreaking about what's happening in Gaza now, what is more heartbreaking than the people that are dying is more the places, the cultural places that used to be like so central for us that were bombed and no longer there, like the mosques, like the universities, like
yeah.
the markets.
Yeah.
We have the gold market. We have a Shawa center. We have like Al-Qattan center. Like all of these beautiful, beautiful cultural spaces were gone. So a lot of the culture of Gaza and the history of Gaza is not there anymore.
that's the idea, isn't it? I mean, when people talk about genocide and these people start to nitpick and say, oh, the birth rate's gone up. Either they're stupid and they don't know, or they're being stupid they're being ignorant on purpose, which is to say, genocide is about wiping out a people, and there's a lot of ways to try to wipe out a people, and one way is to try to wipe out everything beautiful in their culture, whether it's their music or their language. You know, like in Canada, they had these residential schools where First Nations people, Native people, were abducted, basically stolen by the church, and taken to these schools, these kids. And if they spoke their native language, they had needles put in their tongues. Because the colonial power understands that as long as people have a cultural memory, they will exist as a people, and they will resist you. So there's this fantasy that if you just, you know, wipe out Palestinian culture, you'll wipe out Palestinian memory, and then Israel won't have to deal with this Palestinian question or problem. And that's genocide. Oh my God, I did not mean for there to be confetti at that moment. Instagram, come on, read the room. I'm talking about genocide here, and you give me confetti. It's crazy. These hand signals trigger it. Anyway, you get the point.
Yeah, I absolutely get the point, because they think once there's a place is not there anymore, then our memory will not be there. But we will always carry it, you know? Nakba, we had the Nakba, we had different events in our throughout the Palestinian history. And Palestinians have always managed, through the culture, through the whole existence, just by existing in this identity, to carry it through, you know? Like, it will continue also, like, even as much as, like, Gaza looks very destroyed now, like, people in Gaza will not stop being people in Gaza, and they will not stop existing. They will not stop bringing their culture, or living their culture, actually, because it's not for us, it's more living the culture.
If there's one thing Palestinians know how to do, it's rebuild.
Yeah.
And remember.
It's rebuild. It's a culture of hope based on rebuilding and anchoring in the core values of the culture, which is like resilience, existence, and culture, and togetherness and community. Even though in diaspora, there's many Palestinians in diaspora, but the Palestinian community is still strong, and it's still having its voice loud and clear.
Louder than ever, actually. Louder than ever.
Yes.
You can feel that, right? I'm not imagining that. Like, there's like suddenly Palestinians are this chorus of people who people didn't realize were there, who are can't be ignored anymore. That's what I'm noticing.
Yeah.
What does that?
I mean, look.
What does that feel like?
When I was living here in Alentejo, I can just tell you from my personal experience, it was like, oh, I'm a Palestinian, but okay, like there was not so much emphasis on that.
Yeah.
Mainly because of the community around, and like trying to understand the whole thing of identity, how much it's related. Sorry, just a moment. Okay. Yeah, I was saying, can you still hear me?
Yes, very well.
Okay. Yeah, I was saying it feels really good, actually, that more than ever now, the Palestinian voice and situation is really heard. Because for many, many years, it was as if it was not there anymore. Like, many people were not thinking that Gaza had blockade, for example, since 17 years. And I tell to people, hey, no, we in Gaza have been living under blockade and have been living under siege for many, many years. It's not new. It didn't start on the 7th of October.
Right.
And I wanted to make a song about it didn't start on the 7th of October. You know, it's been always there for us as Palestinians. And now people come to me and say, like, how do you guys manage? Like, how do you keep up with all the stuff that are happening, that keeps on happening? And I realize it's also part of the Palestinian culture as well, like this persistence, this hope, this resilience. Yeah.
Well, so my ears pricked up when you said you wanted to write a song. Are you a songwriter?
I do write songs, yes.
Okay, great. So do I.
All right.
You should write that song. Someone in the chat said you should write that song. And if you ever come up with
right.
any, if you ever,
write,
if you ever
I'm
come up with,
I'm not a good composer.
Yeah,
I'm not a good composer. I can
if
write
you,
a song, but
if you come up with, if you come up with lyrics, and you want someone to write music to it, or if you have a melody that you know, please send
yeah.
it to me. I would be honored to. I mean, it probably be better if a Palestinian composer did, but if you wanted to make a lot of news. You get a Jewish
okay.
composer with a Palestinian
okay.
lyricist will go viral like crazy.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. I can send it to you. I think I have lyrics already since 3 months running in my head because of the whole events.
Well, of
happening.
Course, that's what happens with a song. It just visits you until you say, okay, what do you want? I'll write you. Fine.
It keeps staying in the head until there's no more escape from it anymore.
Exactly. All right, I have to switch pots
yeah.
because I just realized I don't have a lid big enough. My kitchen is so not well stocked, it's crazy. But I'm going to do my best here, hopefully not spill.
But you can cover it with something else, like something metal, anything metal.
I don't have anything metal. All I would be able to use is foil, and I want to be able to keep the steam in for the rice. So I've got a lid for this other one.
Okay.
It's a little bit smaller, and that'll work.
Okay. I'm also actually looking for a lid, but I found one.
Okay, and we're only a half an hour in. Now, how long is this rice going to take
yes.
to cook, do you think?
I think it's going to take at least 15 more minutes. Like
okay.
I would make the fire higher,
yeah.
and then when it boils, I will lower it.
It's already boiled. I just need to reboil it, and then I'll put the lid on.
Yeah.
And it's a clear. It's a clear lid, so
okay.
you'll be able to see how the...
So some people are saying, Habibis, that song should be released ASAP. All right. Okay. We do it. Ah, it looks good.
Yeah?
Nice.
Good color?
Nice, yeah. Yeah, I like the color.
Yeah, it looks good to me.
It looks good.
You know,
yeah,
I shared a song with you that I'm working on. I can't reveal any details.
Okay.
But it's a very different kind of very different kind of song on the same topic, but different. But you gave it your thumbs up, which was really heartening because I wanted to make sure a Palestinian liked it. I'm collaborating with some people
yeah.
on it. It'll be out soon.
Yeah. I'm looking forward for it to be out.
Yeah.
I'll share it with some people.
Yeah.
It's a great one.
Thank
I liked
you.
It.
Thank you. All right. It's boiling.
Great. I would like to share a poem by a Gazan poet and writer and college professor. Because we are live and I would like to share it with people, a poem.
I would love that.
Maybe some people know it and maybe not.
Who's the poet?
Rifat al-Ar'ir.
Rest in peace. Rest in power.
Yes. Yes, rest in power and peace.
Say that again, sorry.
I was saying I took 2 lectures with him.
Oh, wonderful.
He was a wonderful person.
My brother Aaron had befriended him in the past few years and they were in touch, you know, and just spoke so
okay.
highly of him. And
Yeah.
Please share the poem with us.
Okay, I will read it, And he was assassinated, for those who don't know, he was assassinated by Israel on the 7th of December. And he's a Palestinian professor, poet, writer, community person. And his poem goes like this. If I must die, you must live. To tell my story, to sell my things, to buy a piece of cloth, and some strings, make it white with a long tail, so that a child somewhere in Gaza, while looking heaven in the eye, awaiting his dad, who left in place and bid no one farewell, not even to his flesh, not even to himself. Sees the kite, my kite, you made, flying up above, and thinks for a moment an angel is there, bringing back love. If I must die, let it bring hope. Let it be a tear.
It's extraordinary. And English was his second language.
Yeah.
And he wrote in English.
He was an English language professor, actually, in university.
Yeah.
Yeah. I studied English with him, actually, the two lectures I had.
The thing that strikes me this time, and it's just a technical mm-hmm. thing, but it's incredible. And I don't mm-hmm. know if he—I don't know if he meant it. I bet he did, or on some level he did. Let it be a tale, T A L E. What's the What's the other spelling of that word? T A I L, and that's what a kite has.
Yes.
So just the image of that, mm-hmm. You know, a story, but also like this angelic thing flapping in the wind. It's heart-stoppingly good.
Yes, it is. It's really powerful. For me, the powerful part is bringing back love, like this angel that comes back to bring back love in. And this is something really powerful that reminds me also of something in the culture that is so much there, no matter what, like this love, the deep love for life. Mm-hmm. And I felt that in his poem too.
Mm. And the awareness.
As much as there's death, there's connection to love and life. So what were you saying?
No, I'm glad you said what you said. Just the awareness that there is, even if there isn't life after death, like, I don't, you know, you don't have to be religious to believe that, you know, I will live after I die, but others will live after I die, and that I have a responsibility to them, you know, to be an ancestor they can be proud of, and that you want to leave them something, and even that my death means something. He says, if I must die, let it be a tale, not let my life be a tale, let my death be a tale, you know. And a lot of us, we don't relate to our deaths as a kind of obligation. There's a beautiful book, actually, by a good friend of mine and a mentor, Canadian author, called Die Wise by Stephen Jenkinson. And he talks about relating to death that way, that in sane cultures, in whole cultures that haven't lost their way, there's an understanding that dying is not something that happens to you, it's something you do. And it's something that you have an obligation to do well, and that'll have consequences for life.
Yeah.
And just that awareness, that indigenous awareness, and also coupled that with the awareness that comes with being a people under occupation, a people in a resistance, and a people of love. I mean, it's just, it's amazing.
Yeah. It is. I mean, I don't know, like, what I personally believe I do. I think there's something in the stars and universe that is waiting for us after death. Death is not the end, actually. Mm. I don't think death is the end. We live we just live different lives. But anyway, I don't want to go into that because people have different beliefs.
Well, but it's beautiful to hear yours, you know? I think... Mm-hmm. Unless you avoid the topic, it's a beautiful thing to consider. They say energy can't be created or destroyed, so maybe consciousness can't be created or destroyed. Maybe consciousness just transforms. But what I don't expect is that Daniel, like my biography, my identity, my personality, will survive. I think that has to die, and that's the hardest thing for human beings to let go of. You know, I want to have my memories. I want to have my specific quirks and my personalities and the things I like about myself and the things I don't like about myself. And that's the stuff that doesn't last. That's the stuff we get to enjoy for a while, and then we got to give it back. That's probably my belief system, which means enjoy it, but don't get attached to it.
Yeah, I believe the same thing actually in this one. On this one, exactly the same, but at some point, also some of it might come along to the next life.
It's possible.
Who knows?
Hopefully the stuff that's worth keeping.
Yeah.
It would be shitty if I arrived in the next life and like all I was able to keep was like remembering all the lyrics to, I don't know, Coldplay or something like that. I'd be really pissed off. Of course, I don't know. I don't know any of the lyrics to Coldplay now, so that wouldn't happen. But anyway, You get what I'm saying,
right? Yeah, I get what you're saying. I get it. That's what I'm
You're
hoping.
Like, damn, that's what I got to keep. Come on.
Yeah.
All right, I'm just gonna stir this a bit.
Yeah, I've been making some meditation because I've been having this big dream that has been coming with me since it was always this dream of meeting with death because I've lost family members and I like along my lineage, like we lost always so many people in young age, including my grandmother and my grandfather and my aunt who died to cancer. And then we had a cousin who died in war. And there was always this feeling of like, okay, death. There's something so overwhelmingly scary about it, like scary. And then there's some part that is about this when I started to work in this afterlife work of working on the energy, on the soul level, let's say. I've been having this dream since 7th of October that I was standing, I mean, this is like a bit spiritual stuff, yeah? Like I was standing in the middle and from the east and the west, there was people coming to me. There was people like tired, exhausted, injured, or covered with blood. And I was supporting them to cross somewhere. In the dream, I could not recognize. I wanted to recognize, where's my cousins who died? Where's my relatives who died? Where are all these people that I know who died? But instead, I couldn't recognize. And I would assume that it was maybe either a Jewish or a Muslim who died. So from both sides who died, who were suffering. And then in the end, I was like just part of a channel of bringing them into the light. Right? And then there was a grandmother telling me in the dream about forgetting her pot that was still full of food on the stove. And I was telling her, we can take care of everything. You need to believe that passing in peace is the way. And ever since, I have been just doing meditation and supporting these people who die, finding this light to good. Mm. Not sure what it is actually, but just giving some rest, some peace, because it's so rough how people die.
Yeah.
Are you eating already?
No. I was just tasting the rice to see if it was soft yet.
Okay.
I'm not gonna just start. Well, yeah. I mean, everything I said about dying and being an obligation and all that. I mean, that assumes that people have the freedom to die when they're supposed to die. When your life is taken from you, that's my biggest fear, actually. Like dying suddenly. Or, I mean, painfully would be even worse, but an accident or an attack, you know, I don't expect to be attacked most of the time, but it's like an accident, a car crash, a bridge collapsing, an airplane crash, something like that. The suddenness of it and the foreignness of it and just the theft of it. Like one minute you have your life and then this thing happens that like wasn't supposed to happen. And what could be more like that than a sustained genocidal attack from the fourth largest military in the world? and the entire world just letting it happen. You know, I mean, it's just beyond me.
I know.
It's beyond all of us.
I know, beyond all of us. And that's why also specifically these people who died in this harsh way, harsh life circumstances, and in this sudden way that they have someone meditating to support mm-hmm. them into mm-hmm. I don't know what is it supporting actually, but I guess in my view I want to send them light and love. Because it hurts so much the way they die. I guess this is the way to relate of the pain of the way that they were killed and they were brutally dehumanized and genocided. But it feels like, it will not stop there. Like, I feel like we need to embrace them in a different, like also to keep embracing them, those who died, speaking up about them and embracing them in whatever way we can. Yeah,
that's beautiful.
I don't know.
No, I love that. That reminds me of something else that Stephen Jenkinson says in the book. He says he was like a death counselor for a long time. Mm-hmm. And he hears people, especially in North America, use the phrase, "I lost my father last year." Or when we lost my sister to cancer, whatever. And he says, "I want to ask you something, and I'm not accusing you of anything, but I just want to ask you something. How did you lose them? Like, we lose our car keys. We misplace them. We lose our way because we take the wrong turn." He says, "Just because they died, you are not obligated to lose them. Losing them is an act." And of course, it's a very encouraged act in our culture, which is death phobic. But again, a sane culture doesn't let the dead be lost. And it sounds to me like what you're doing in that vision or that dream is you're there as, here's the way, you know, you're not lost. Because they died in the absolute opposite way of what we would all want for ourselves, which is surrounded by love and comfort and a chance to release everything, you know? And so, like, you're just unwilling for these lives to be lost, even if the people are gone. You're not willing to allow their goneness to be gone, in a way. That's what I get.
Yeah, it's exactly that. And to honor them and to give them this. Because there's so much dehumanization by the occupation of these lives. And I feel I don't normally do it in a circle or with other people, but this is what I do at nights when I cannot sleep. I just meditate on sending these energies and these vibrations mm-hmm. to these people who even died without their families saying goodbye to them, without being buried properly, without being like even acknowledged in their bodies, like recognized in their bodies. Yeah. Like, this is like so much horror actually of way of death, but to bring them light, warmth, comfort, love, without knowing them, without really knowing them, who is the person. And I recognize that I don't need to know who is that person. It's like, it's basically sending them love.
They're your people. They're your people. And in a larger way, they're all of our people. But they're really your people.
I mean, they are all
they're all of ours.
Yes, they're for
us. Yeah.
Yeah, they are all of us.
Yeah, but they're yours in a special way. So here's my dish. It's ready, I think. I just need to add the fish, but I will wait for you. So I forgot the parsley too. So I'm going to have to get parsley and lemon and add that to the leftovers. I'll be eating this for weeks. So now I'm just going to sort of add the fish to it and mix it in.
Yeah, you can add it already now.
Okay.
And then, it should be okay. It should be really tasty, actually.
Everyone having fun out there?
Do you have...
What's that?
Piri-piri?
Piri-piri?
Do you
no.
have piri-piri?
No. No, I have chimichurri.
Okay, because it's good with it. Well,
oh.
You know, also, I just want to tell you about a little thing that we do next to Sayadieh. It's a specific Gazan thing. Like, it's called Dagga Ghazaliya. And it's green pepper with garlic. Okay, some people are making... Okay, I'm not... They're making comments about the noise and... Like cooking with Daniel. I think it's fun cooking with Daniel. Okay.
All right. If you're not enjoying the noise, there's lots of other cooking channels you can turn to. We're very low tech here. We have a staff of one who can't even clean up, and who's, you should see the mess in this kitchen, but he's making a damn good idea.
I can relate to your cooking. You know what I did? Like last year I was cooking in a festival for 500 people. Or sometimes even 600 people. And
my God,
I would make a whole lot of mess in the kitchen. I have 10 people and I would make a whole lot of mess freaking out about cooking for 700 people. So it's normal to create a mess in the kitchen. It's
and here, I'm cooking for 71,000 people because literally all my followers are going to watch this. Just kidding.
Uh-huh. Okay, so I want to tell you about the dakka because
the side dish.
Yeah, the side dish. So it's spicy pepper and some garlic, and you crush them together. Why it's called dakka? Because we do this with it. You know, I don't know how to describe it.
You pound it like you you.
Yeah.
Or you grate it. What is it?
It's this.
Like you're smashing it.
Yeah. Okay, I don't know.
You pound it like you would making pesto, you know, you sort of bang it.
Yes, exactly. And you put the garlic and the pepper and then you add the lemon to it and some salt. And this is really tasty next to the sayadieh.
I bet it is.
And then you can put tahini salad next to it.
Mixed tahini?
It's tahina salad next to it.
Tahina salad, yeah. Well, I do have some tahina, so maybe I'll drizzle a little bit on here.
Yeah.
Would it taste good, like as a little dip or something like that, or is it good enough without it?
You can put, like, actually, you can do whatever you like. You can either make a salad or make a sauce and then eat it.
But you know what? It's true. I have some salad, and I can make a little salad dressing, actually.
Yeah. Tahina salad.
Yeah, tahina and olive oil, basically. And I wish I had lemon, but I'll have to get that later.
All right. Okay. Well, if you put it on a little salad, it should be okay. Yeah. Tahina is delicious next to it. Okay. Okay, Marianne asks if we can put tahina with yogurt. Is it good with fish? Actually, no, I wouldn't recommend tahina with yogurt. Sorry. I cannot play the piano. My daughter is learning. There's someone asking me if I can play the piano.
Piano takes a while.
Are you gonna have the meal with someone, Daniel?
No, I live alone. I eat alone. I'll have a few bites with all of you, and then I'll log off and enjoy the rest myself.
All right. Great. Because in Gaza, when you eat something, you give for your neighbors also. I don't know if you have neighbors.
I do, but I think they work during the day.
We cook for all of the people around. You give for this neighbor, for that neighbor, for your
okay.
mother.
Well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to leave a note on my neighbor's door. And I'm going to say, I made a Palestinian dish, and I was told that the thing to do... By the way, we can't see you anymore. It's all dark.
I don't know why.
Turn your camera off? Did you press a button at the bottom or something like that? There you are. Hi. And that a Palestinian told me that if I don't offer some sadaiya, is that how you say it?
Sayadieh.
If I don't offer some sayadieh to my neighbors, I will be cursed for 7 years. So please accept this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sounds good.
I'm really looking forward to this. This looks amazing. Got to heat this fish up a little bit.
It does. I'm going to check mine. Mine, I think, is ready too. The kids are really looking forward to eat it.
What time is it where you are? It's almost 7, right?
Yeah, it's almost 7, so it's exactly dinner time.
Excellent.
Us. Yeah.
And it's exactly lunchtime here.
Yeah.
I like a 5-hour difference, you know? I feel like that's not so long. Even though you're in Europe and I'm here.
Yeah.
All right. Here's my little salad.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the dressing.
Thank you. Saha. So people are telling you saha, and it means saha saha. It's a word where it means exactly bon appetit.
Oh, really?
Well,
shukran is thank you. Is shukran thank you?
Shukran is thank you.
And all right.
Saha is the singular and sahtain is the plural. It's like bon appetit. Okay. You would like me, some people. So look, here's mine.
So I think I added probably more turmeric than you. That looks great.
Yeah.
And here's mine with the fish.
Yeah, you probably added more turmeric because my turmeric, I got out of, like, I ran out of turmeric at some point.
Okay.
So you put only a small spoon. Normally, it should be a bit more.
Well,
a small spoon is not enough. I would add a big spoon or like even a bit more.
I'm older than you, and turmeric is anti-inflammatory. So for my aging joints, I need the extra.
No, it's actually perfect with more turmeric because the color should be yellowish, actually.
Yeah.
But I ran out of turmeric.
Oh, gotcha.
Just like you didn't have lemon, I ran out of turmeric.
Got it. Just cutting up some carrots for
the. The color is not so yellow. Not completely yellow. But the taste. Yeah, looks good. Okay. Mmm.
All right.
It's so yummy.
I'm about to serve it. Are we ready? Can I put it on my plate?
Yeah.
Excellent. Come here, you. Wow, this is so exciting. I've never made anything quite like this.
Mm-hmm. And this is a Gazan dish to remember the fishermen in Gaza, to remember the people in Gaza, the culture.
There we go.
To bring them. Oh, wow. It looks really good. Really good.
So, yeah, this is dedicated to them.
Yes, it's dedicated to Gaza.
And Haneen, really, thank you for sharing your culture with us in this way and letting me learn a new dish and everything you brought. It was, it's really been amazing. I've had such a good time. So I'm going to have a few ceremonial bites in front of everybody, and then I think I'll say goodbye so I can go enjoy it.
All right. Thank you, Daniel, for hosting me today.
Of course, my pleasure.
Thank you to everyone who was with us today.
It's really good. Yeah. Needs a bit of salt, I think, but I'll do that off camera.
You can add some salt if you want.
I will.
Yeah.
Haneen, I appreciate you.
All right.
It's great to do this with you.
Thank you. Great to do it with you too.
All right.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.